Church. We'll be looking at the book of Revelation over the next several weeks. So tune in, watch, come to in-person worship, learn some things about the book of Revelation and how the book speaks to us today. Just a couple of announcements. I want to remind you on Wednesday night, June the 16th, 5:45, right here in this room, we'll have a youth planning meeting as we look ahead to the fall. We also have some youth events coming up in the summer. One, on June the 26th, we're hosting a scavenger hunt. It's all going to be done by text message, and the kids are out looking for a treasure, and then we're going to bring them back here for a time of fellowship. So do be in prayer for these events, these things that are coming up in the near future. So we open with worship. I invite you to stand. We'll sing together, Lord, I Need You. I'm I invite you to remain standing for a call to worship is printed in the bulletin, and all in unison we say, the wind blew this week, it knocked me off balance, disrupted my heat days and commandeered my nights. The wind blew this week, it stole my finances, battled my peace, and infected my health. Did you hear how? Did you see the waste it left behind? Speak to the wind, rebuke the storm, Lord, calm our souls. We fall back to sleep, peace be still. We awoke the house, peace be still. We dressed and we ate, peace be still. We navigated the traffic, peace be still. We greeted and we fellowship, still us now in this, your holy place. Amen. You can go ahead and be seated. I want you to be in prayer for our sound man today. Timmy's doing an awesome job. Yes, indeed. Pray for Craig and Belinda. They are traveling. They went to Tennessee to see Caleb, and they're going to be on their way back sometime later today. And also, Brenda was one of our church members that had surgery this week on Friday. She's back home resting and doing well. So please continue to be in prayer for her. Anita Motley also had surgery this week. She's home, doing well, so continue to pray for her as well. So we take this time to go before the Lord for prayer. We do remember all those who are sick, who are in need of God's healing touch. Of course, we do remember all those who continue to mourn the loss of loved ones. Of course, we want to pray for our world, our military, our nation's leaders as well. So I invite you to pray with me as we begin with these words. Loving God, when we are inclined to worry or panic, speak with authority to us. Speak directly through Jesus so that fears may be confronted and our faith reinstated. Through him and in him, let us spend our days and nights with the courage and peace of those who know they are being saved and sustained by an imputable grace. That means an awesome grace, y'all. And to me and to you be the glory and the praise. God, we do thank you for your grace. Your grace which sustains us each and every day. Your grace which holds us up and reminds us of your great love for us. God, we're thankful. Thankful for the opportunity to gather in your presence. We know that you are with us. We know that you sustain us. We know that your right hand is there to pick us up when we fall. Father, we pray for those who are sick, those who are recovering from surgeries, those who are anticipating surgery. We pray, dear God, that you would be with them, to comfort them, to strengthen them, to bring healing and peace. For those, Lord, who are grieving the loss of loved ones, we ask that you would be with them. That you, Lord, would comfort them and fill them with your peace. That you, Lord, would sustain them with your grace. And fill them with the blessed hope that we have through your Son, Jesus Christ. God, we praise you for the opportunity that you've given us today to open your word and to seek the many truths that you have for us. Help us, dear God, to be attentive to your word today. And help us, Lord, to not just be hearers, but help us to go forth to do your very word as we live it out and we apply. apply it to our lives each and every day. Father, grant us peace, and grant us wisdom, and grant us courage, that we may serve you in this world, pointing others towards a loving relationship with your Son, Jesus. And God, we ask all these things in his name today, the very one who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This past Thursday, we buried one of our dear members at the Pleasant Ridge United Methodist Church. Christine Brannon was 96 years old, lived a wonderful, wonderful life. And at the close of her service, I sang this song. It's new to me, but I invite you to listen to it, and if you want to try and sing along, you can, but I hope you find great inspiration in these words, and you're more than welcome to stand where you are, stretch your legs, because I've got a long, long sermon today. but go ahead and do that if you like. But the song is called "He's Always Been Faithful." you have your Bibles with me today, I invite you to open to Revelation chapter 1 as we begin our brand new sermon series starting today entitled Dear Church, Dear Church. As we come to this awesome, awesome book, we know that this is a letter written by the Apostle John as he was exiled on the island of Patmos, just off the coast of Greece, imprisoned for his faith in Jesus and for sharing the gospel with others. And he writes this famous letter to seven churches that are now in modern-day Turkey. It's a vision that God shares with him through his son, Jesus Christ. And I think as we look at this book, there's a message here for all of us. Things that we can glean, apply to our own lives of faith. And hopefully these words, as we study them, will strengthen our own faith and our own walk with Jesus. Because I truly believe that that's what these words are intended to do. To encourage us in our faith. I'm going to be reading from the Message Bible, and I invite you to hear these words, beginning in verse number 1. A revealing of Jesus, the Messiah, and God gave it to make plain to his servants what is about to happen. He published and delivered it by angel to his servant John, and John told everything that he saw. God's word, the witness of Jesus Christ. How blessed the reader, how blessed the heavens and keepers of these oracle words, all the words written in this book. Time is just about up. I, John, am writing this to the seven churches in Asia province. All the best to you from the God who is, the God who was, and the God about to arrive. And from the seven spirits assembled before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, loyal witness, firstborn from the dead, ruler of all earthly kings. Glory and strength to Christ, who loves us, who blood washed our sins from our lives, who made us a kingdom, priests for his Father forever, and yes, he is on his way. Riding the clouds, he'll be seen by every eye. Those who mocked and killed him will see him. People from all nations and all times will tear their clothes in lament. Oh, yes. The Master declares, I am A to Z. I'm the God who is, the God who was, and the God who is about to arrive. I am the sovereign strong. I, John, with you all the way in the trial, and the kingdom and the passion of patience in Jesus was on the island called Patmos because of God's word, the witness of Jesus. It was Sunday. And I was in the Spirit praying. I heard a loud voice behind me, trumpet clear and piercing, write what you see into a book. Send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. I turned and I saw the voice. I saw a gold menorah with seven branches. And in the center, the Son of Man in a robe and gold breastplate. Hair a blizzard of white. Eyes pouring fire blaze. Both feet furnace fire bronze. And his voice a cataract. Right hand holding the seven stars. His mouth a sharp biting sword. His face a perigee sun. I saw this and fainted dead at his feet. His right hand pulled me upright. His voice reassured me, don't fear. I am first, I am last, I am alive. I died, but I came to life, and my life is now forever. See these keys in my hand, they open and lock death's door. They open and lock hell's gates. Now write down everything you see, things that are, things about to be. The seven stars you saw in my right hand, and the seven-branched gold menorah. Do you want to know what's behind them? The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The menorah's seven branches are the seven churches. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So we come to this book of Revelation. And it's my hope that we find great inspiration in its words as we study this together. But when we consider reading Revelation, we come away sometimes with more questions than we have answers. We find sometimes that the symbolism in the book is difficult to understand. We are perplexed about the beasts that are in the book. We try to figure all these things out as we wrestle with this book. But one of the things that I want to share with you that I think is so important as we try to find understanding and to make sense of this book, it is the whole idea of context. Context. We cannot and must not take the things from this book out of context. And John does this wonderful thing in chapter 1 by establishing the context for us as he sees this vision and he writes it down for the purpose of seven churches in modern day Turkey. But we glean so much inspiration from this letter that was written to these churches. Over the course of history, many Bible scholars, people have looked at this book and have interpreted it in four different ways. And I've given you the names of those four different ways on your bulletin. But I want to kind of give you the gist of the definitions and what they mean and hopefully make some connections and things along the way as we go. But one of the first understandings is some people come to this book and they see it from a futuristic point of view. And they look at the book and they say, well, most of everything that is in this book must take place in some point, at some point in the future after it was written. We know that this letter was written sometime around 90 A.D. And so a futurist says, what we read in this book must come at some point in the future. Now, there's an anti-voice to that, and that is the preterist. Look at the prefix of the word preterist, P-R-E, it's a prefix. And anytime we use pre, we're talking about things that come what? Before. So what the preterist says is, when we look at the book of Revelation, we understand that John was writing about things that happened before he actually wrote it in 90 A.D. Things are starting to get a little confusing now, aren't they? Just in the interpretation, but Bible scholars look at this and they all wrestle with the understanding and the interpretation of this book. Some think futuristically, some think preteristically, and then we have the historical criticism of the book. The historicist theory says that there are events in this book that are tied to different aspects of history. And so we begin to look at the symbols and all the different things that are going on in this book, and we begin to apply them to historical things. You know, this happened a lot during World War I and World War II, especially as the Allies would come together. And a historicist would say, well, if this and this is happening, well, this is pointing to something in the book of Revelation. You know, this happens a lot. You know, 2008, can you remember what happened? The market began to take a nosedive. And do you remember what all the news stations were saying? They were saying, this is it. This is the end of the world, right? This is Armageddon, apocalypse, all these things, right? And guess what? We're still sitting here today. And then, just last year, the same thing kind of happened, right? The coronavirus is the end of the world, right? And yet, we're still here today. And we've all seen the articles, and we've all seen the predictions. Maybe we've even seen somebody holding a poster. The end of the world is coming on such and such a date. And that date comes, and it goes. And we're still sitting here today. So that's kind of what the historicist point of view does, looking at the symbols and different things and applying these to history. And then we come to a fourth understanding of the book, the idealistic view of the book. And the idealist says, let's look for eternal truths. Things that are unchanging, but yet things that we can't pinpoint on a calendar. Such eternal truths are, one of these days, Jesus is coming back. Another eternal truth is that when we go through difficulties, we know that God is with us, and we take that by faith. So the idealist says, let's look at the big overarching picture here, a picture of faith, a picture that's meant to inspire our faith. And we hold on to those truths and we claim them for our very own. So as I mentioned earlier, now the context of this book is John writing from the island of Patmos, and I've got a map with a red circle around the island. It's off the coast of Greece. And he's writing to these seven churches in Asia Minor. And I think that as he writes to these churches, he reminds them of something that I reminded all of y'all about last Sunday when I shared with you the big red tractor. Mission. Purpose, the very thing that's intended for us to hold us together, to give us purpose, that we go forth in the name of Jesus sharing the good news. And as I shared with you last week, when we do that and we're committed to that, amazing things happen. And so John, as we begin to see, especially as we look at chapter 2 and chapter 3, is reminding these seven churches of their mission, their purpose, their reason for being. And this question comes forth from this, a question that asks, are you ready? Are you ready? When we look at these churches, John begins with the church of Ephesus. And he says to Ephesus, you have lost your love for Jesus. Their attention was being turned aside to anything but Jesus. And he says, you're not loving him the way you're supposed to be loving him. And to the church in Smyrna, he says, y'all have a lack of confidence. you're allowing your circumstances and other people to put you down, and you're not living into your full mission and purpose. And to the church in Pergamum, he says you're tolerating ungodliness. You're allowing folks to dabble in all these other things that are not godly. He says to the church in Thyatira, you're being permissive of idolatry. Your people are not only trying to worship God, but they're worshiping other things also. He says to Sardis, y'all have departed from the faith that you originally had. To the church in Philadelphia, he says, there's some things you're doing well, but there's certainly some weaknesses, some things that could be shored up and addressed, things that you could be doing better. And the church in Laodicea, we all know this one, he says to them, you are neither hot nor cold, you are just, see, I told you y'all knew that one, you're just lukewarm. You're not fully committed. You're not fully devoted. You're not all in. You're just there. Just lukewarm. And one of the things that we see that John is doing by addressing each of these issues of each of these churches is he's inviting them to come back. He's inviting them to come back to their strong faith in Jesus Christ. This is an invitation for them to see what they had become and where they needed to make some progress to come back and be everything that God intended for them to be. He's inviting them to recommit in the face of trials and circumstances that all of us face from time to time, because he knows when our faith is strong, we can endure. We can endure. We've all been through trying circumstances where our faith has been tested, yes. And yet God says, if we're going to make it through, our faith must be shored up, depending on him and depending on one another, strengthening one another's faith. One of the things that kind of leads to these four different interpretations of the book of Revelation is chapter 1. And verse number 1, we say we don't get too far into the book, right? And this is what we read. This is a revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the events that must soon take place. For the longest time, historians had assumed that the persecution of the church at the time that the book of Revelation was written was very widespread. But after examining and looking a little bit more closely at history, what Bible scholars discovered was that the persecution of the church was not all that widespread during the writing of this letter. But as they stepped back, they saw that in a few years, the persecution of the church ramped up. So as John is writing this, the events that will soon take place, he's writing to seven churches that had not quite experienced the full-blown effect of Christian persecution. It would be about 200 years later when a Roman emperor by the name of Diocletian would come to the throne, and he would move eastward, away from Rome towards these other churches in Asia. And there he would unleash horrific persecution among the churches. And the correlation we find as John invites these churches to come back, to shore up their faith, to recommit themselves, he knows that that is what it's going to take for them to be able to endure what was coming. Those events that will soon take place. You know, history tells us that the persecution up until this time was not all that widespread. And we see this even in the example that we have in the book of Acts with the Apostle Paul. You know, he was arrested for preaching the gospel, but what happened? He was shipped to Rome for trial, conviction, and execution. A lot of the persecution was taking place right in Rome itself. But Diocletian says, as he felt threatened by the Christians, we need to move out and annihilate as many as we can. It was just a few years after Diocletian reigned that another emperor came to power known as Constantine the Great. And of all the Roman emperors that preceded him, Constantine was the one who left all the paganism and idolatry behind, and he converted to Christianity. And the Roman Empire became a Christian state through the Edict of Milan. And it was the Edict of Milan that said, we need to go easy on these Christians now. And Constantine helped to spread the message of Christianity throughout the Roman Empire. But John's question prevails. Are you ready? Are you ready? When trials come, when disadvantages come, when someone is after you, will you endure? Are you ready? We start to look at the idea of what readiness looks like when we're facing turbulent times. And Jesus himself addresses this idea in the Gospel of Matthew in chapters 24 and 25, which is often referred to as the little apocalypse. And Jesus talks about the end of times. He talks about the coming of the Son of Man. He talks about persecutions, but he also talks of it in terms of being ready. Ready. And this is what he says in Matthew 24. You must be ready all the time, for the Son of Man will come when least expected. He's talking about our faith, preparing our faith, strengthening our faith, even in the waiting. And by the way, it's in the same passage of Scripture that Jesus says, no one knows the time, the hour, or the day when the Son of Man is going to come back. Even that little man on the corner holding a cardboard sign saying Jesus will come back on such and such a day, he doesn't even know. Jesus says the only one who does know is God in heaven. But in the meantime, be ready. Be ready. In chapter 25 of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus uses two illustrations to talk about being ready. The first story he tells is about 10 virgins who are told that the bridegroom is coming, and they were to take their oil lamps and wait outside for the bridegroom to come so that when he comes to town in the middle of the night, he will see their lamps burning. And Jesus says, five of these virgins were really smart, and five of them, I love what the Message Bible says, they were really silly. Because when the silly ones went out, they didn't take enough oil with them. And their lights burned out. Because the bridegroom did not come at the time that they were expecting, and they didn't have enough oil to last. But the other five virgins, the smart ones, they not only took enough oil, they took more than enough, because they were ready and they were prepared. Jesus also tells this other story about a man who had given his servant some money to invest. And some of them squandered their money, and some of them invested it and put it to good use over a period of unknown time. And when the master came back, he was so proud of those who had invested their gifts and their talents and their money, because they had made so much more over this period of time. They were ready for when the time came. And I think this message is there for us too. Are we ready? As we practice our faith and we shore it up day by day, waiting on Jesus to come. Are you ready? You know, some of the language that we find in the book of Revelation, we refer to as apocalyptic language. We look at the very basic meaning of that. It's simply this vision of heavenly secrets that can make sense of the earthly realities that we encounter. And if we were to listen closely for the secret that we must be willing to hear and to understand and to grasp, is that we must be ready. And I love what the Bible says, in season and out of season, we must be ready. Last week, I shared with you a number that I wanted you to think about. And I want to get to that number in just a second, because it's an important number. But I've got a couple other numbers to share with you. This first number comes right out of the statistician's report for the Alabama West Florida Conference at the very end of conference that was held just this week. And the statistician reported this number, 120,863. It's a pretty good number, isn't it? But what does it mean? 120,863 is the number of professing members that we have on our books in the Alabama West Florida Conference. 120,000 members. People who say they're believers in Jesus and their faith is strong and they're committed. Right? Now look at this next number. Only 44% of the 120,000 come to church on a regular basis. Less than half of the 120,000 professing members that we have attend church from week to week. And we're asking the question, are you ready? Wow, there goes that community idea, working together, pulling together for common mission and common purpose. A few years ago, I was on the Next Step ministry team for Dothan District, and I served with our district superintendent at the time, who was Sarah Shaver. exploring ideas about a number that I was introduced to a few years ago. Not just introduced to that number, but the significance of that number. And I think this is where we really need to perk up and pay attention. Because it's the number 20. Remember I told you last week, 20? Why is that important? What does that mean? Because it is significant. Now this will probably be just a little more depressing than the 44%. But I want to assure you, I'm going to leave you with some hope before we get done today, okay? This number that I was introduced to says this, that over the next 20 years, beginning this year, the United States of America will see its highest mortality rate than ever before in its history. And when you think about that, you think about that 44% of our 120,000 that sit on our pews from Sunday to Sunday, the vast majority of those 44% fall into that category. Now I'm like thinking 20 years from now, I'm gonna be almost 70. I know you can't believe that because I look pretty good for being almost 50, you know, but I'll be 70. Now look around the room. 20 years. And what it's looking like is that 44% is only going to decline. That is a statistical fact. Are you ready to leave a church behind for the next generation? And then the question that all of us should be concerned about is, what are we going to do about that number? What are we going to do about that number? Because it is something that we will all face at some point or another down the road. A number that we will all have to contend with in one way or another. Are you ready? What can we do about this number? And I want to tell you up front, it's something that I have been preaching on for a very long time. You know, our bishop was well aware of that number. And that's why email after email after email we got from him, and he says, whatever you do, try to offer your worship services online. Because we take a huge risk when we gather together in person dealing with the coronavirus. And as of today, we're approaching the 600,000 mark of people who have passed away in this country alone. And the bishop, as he tells this to the churches, you know what he's thinking of? The longevity of our churches. 20. So what helps us? The thing that I've been preaching on for several months, it comes up time and time again. It's what the Christian Century magazine says, community. We have got to be about relationships and building community. Christian Century magazine says, as people come back after the pandemic, that the thirst will increase for authentic community where moral formation and relationships of meaning can prosper. In social isolation, we have learned the truth of Frederick Buechner's words. You can survive on your own. You can grow strong on your own. You can prevail on your own, but you cannot become human on your own. And the remedy is that congregations will need to play a heightened role in providing thick human community, actively building relationships with the people that are already in our midst, and being active in establishing new relationships out there, inviting people to come in and to be a part of the community. We have this opportunity as we ask that question of ourselves: are we ready? Are we ready? Are we prepared to share our faith as God through Christ strengthens our faith so we can withstand the trials that come in these next few years? As I thought about this, and sometimes I've heard people say many times, if we could just get back to normal. You've heard that, right? Yeah. If you're like me, you may have said it. But when you think what normal has been for the Methodist Church for so many years, we've been declining. Declining. Year after year. And sometimes normalcy just brings us back to what was, brings us back to the status quo. And I love the invitation that John gives to these seven churches. He says, you don't want to get back to normal. You don't want to get back to the status quo. You want to get back to being fully alive and in love with Jesus Christ. Because it's Jesus that gives us our mission and our purpose and our reason for being as his church in this world for such a time as this. And I think if anything John would say to us in his letter is, take these words seriously. Take these words seriously. You know, these churches, when they received this letter, had to deal with the hard truth of what they had become. They had to deal with the hard truth and the reality of what they had become. He wrote to them over and over again, I see you're doing this, but you can do things so much better. I see you're doing that, but you're not loving Jesus the way you need to. So we look at this idea of being ready, and our understanding is this: are we becoming everything that God intends for us to be? And if not, if there are weaknesses, if there's issues that need to be shored up, what are we going to do about it? You know, in the big red tractor that I shared with you last Sunday, Francis Chan, the author of the book, said, as the Holy Spirit would move in the New Testament, he saw a church that was unstoppable. But today, he sees a church that is so stoppable. Maybe that's what John was seeing when he wrote to these seven churches in Asia Minor. That if they didn't do something about where they were, that they would be stoppable. Maybe if we hear his invitation and his call to do something about where we are in this hour, God can do something amazing when his people pull together in community, being on mission together. You know, next Sunday, we're going to look at chapter 4. We're speeding right through this, aren't we? chapter 4 of the book of Revelation. And John gets this beautiful vision of heaven. And we're left to answer this question. Is Jesus truly King? Is he truly King of our lives and our hearts? And I think that's the question that those seven churches had to grapple with too. Who truly is Lord of our lives? You know, it's one thing to say Jesus is Savior, but it is an entirely different thing to say that Jesus is King. The question for us to think about as we go into next Sunday is Jesus truly your King, your Lord? Father, we thank you for your love for us and for this opportunity you've given us to hear your word. As you asked us, as you did those seven churches, are you ready? Are you prepared for whatever may come our way? And God, the only way that can happen is for you to truly be King and Lord of our lives, where we submit everything to you. Help us to do that as we ready ourselves to be people of faith in this world, shining the light of Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we do pray. Amen. This next song is one that I sang quite a bit in January and February during our Good series that we did. But I think it speaks a lot to the book of Revelation. It's a song that says, "Behold our God." I invite you to stand where you are as we close. If you don't know it, just kind of hum along if you can, but I promise you by the time we finish Revelation, you're going to be good at the singing the song, okay? "Behold our God." Behold our King. help us to know that you are seated upon the throne of heaven. Help us to live our lives prepared to receive the coming of your Son, Jesus, once again. And in our doubts, may we find confidence in your blessed reassurance that your word stands for all eternity. God bless you all, and have a great week.